So, a little over a week ago, Richard Branson, billionaire founder of Virgin Records, Virgin Atlantic, Virgin Mobile, and a bunch of other companies named after the state of never having had sex, was a passenger aboard a ship built by another of his companies, the VSS Unity, that flew to the edge of outer space. This week, another billionaire, Jeff Bezos, is planning to take his own privately funded flight aboard this spacecraft called New Shepard, which doesn't look anything like a penis. Why would you even say that? Why would Jeff Bezos be flying into space aboard a ship shaped like a giant penis? What could he possibly have to prove by doing that? Anyway, these billionaires launching themselves into space have been getting a lot of attention lately, and I have a question. Can we go back to just having astronauts? I don't mean to suggest that we currently don't have astronauts. We do. There are 7 of them aboard the International Space Station right now. In fact, the International Space Station has been crewed continuously for the last 20 years. And the astronauts who have lived and worked aboard it have come from 10 different countries and represented 5 different national space agencies. And those are just the long-term ISS crew members. If we include short-term visitors and space tourists, the ISS has accommodated people from a total of 19 countries representing 11 different national space agencies and 1 private space tourism company. It's a remarkable accomplishment. The most recent ISS crew flew to the station aboard a spacecraft called the Dragon 2, which was designed and built by SpaceX, the company founded by Elon Musk, who is also planning a private crewed launch for later this year, although he himself won't be aboard. But there will be a billionaire on the mission, just not Elon Musk. It'll be Jared Isaacman, a billionaire you've never heard of, who founded a company called Shift 4 Payments, which you've also never heard of. Didn't want you to worry that there was going to be a privately funded human spaceflight without a billionaire. Anyway, the SpaceX Dragon 2 is the first American-built spacecraft to carry crew to the space station since the space shuttle was retired in 2011. For almost 10 years, astronauts rode to the ISS aboard Russian Soyuz spacecraft. And by the way, I don't object to Americans hitching a ride, or actually paying millions of dollars for a ride, to space aboard a Russian spacecraft. It fosters international relations, reinforces the notion that space shouldn't and doesn't belong exclusively to any single country, and the Soyuz is one of the most durable and versatile spacecraft ever designed. The line is currently in its 4th generation, and some version of it has been in service since the 1960s. What I object to is the reason why NASA has been forced to outsource human spaceflight for the last 10 years, first to Russia and now to SpaceX. That reason is NASA can't afford to do that, and by that I mean the thing the agency was founded to do, for itself anymore. There was a plan for NASA to develop its own successor vehicle to the space shuttle. It was called the Constellation Program, and it would have utilized a spacecraft called the Orion to carry astronauts first to the space station, then back to the moon, and eventually to Mars. When Constellation was first proposed in 2005, its ultimate goal was to land humans on the moon again by the year 2020. Well, we know how that turned out. President Obama decided that Constellation was too expensive and too far behind schedule, and canceled the program in 2010. It was estimated that NASA would need an additional $150 billion in funding for Constellation to meet its goals on schedule, and that was just too much money to spend on space exploration. The military budget that year was over $700 billion, but hey, whatever. After Constellation was canceled, NASA created the Commercial Crew Program, which awards contracts to private companies such as SpaceX to develop their own spacecraft and launch vehicles to carry astronauts to and from the space station. There was already an equivalent program contracting private companies to transport cargo to the ISS, commercial resupply services, but now, for the first time, privately developed spacecraft would be the only vehicles carrying humans into space in the United States. NASA continues to develop its own spacecraft and launch vehicles. There's still the Orion and a heavy rocket called the SLS, both of which are intended to eventually propel astronauts to the moon and ultimately to Mars as part of the Artemis program. SpaceX and other private spaceflight companies have been contracted to work on projects related to Artemis as well. It's not the participation of private companies in the space program that bothers me. NASA has always contracted private companies to build its rockets and spacecraft. Boeing built the Saturn V, North American Aviation built the Apollo Command and Service Module, Grumman built the Lunar Module, the vehicles which carried astronauts to the surface of the moon and back. And honestly, the line that divides what is a NASA spacecraft from what is a privately funded spacecraft is blurry and always has been. The great NASA projects of the 1960s, Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo, were collaborations between NASA's own designers and engineers and the private contractors hired to manufacture those designs. What really bothers me is the receding of NASA into the background. The perception that human spaceflight is no longer a project of humanity or even of a nation, but of a collection of private companies run by egotistical celebrity billionaires who are happy to take NASA's money, but are ultimately focused on building private space tourism businesses and burnishing their own lists of personal accomplishments. Richard Branson, first billionaire in space. First billionaire in space doesn't really sound like something we can all take pride in, does it? The thing is, if a billionaire wants to spend a ton of their own money to live out a fantasy of going to space, I say let them do it. Hell, if I were that rich, I might do the same thing. I'd like to think I'd make sure my employees were making a fair wage and working in suitable conditions first, but hey, different strokes. On the sliding scale of billionaires, Richard Branson is probably one of the better ones. He was accused of sexual assault a few years ago, and he admits he lives in the Virgin Islands because he pays far less in taxes than he would if he lived on the British mainland. It could be worse, I guess. But Branson's recent flight to the edge of space reached less than half the maximum altitude of Alan Shepard's suborbital Mercury flight in 1961. One of the most frequently made arguments in favor of turning space exploration over to the private sector is that it will speed up innovation, because private industry can work faster and more efficiently than the government. Branson's flight took place 16 years after the founding of Virgin Galactic, and over 10 years after development began on Spaceship Two, the class of spacecraft to which Branson's VSS Unity belongs. Alan Shepard's Mercury flight took place less than 3 years after the start of NASA's Mercury project, just over 3 years after the formation of NASA itself. It took Richard Branson's private company 16 years to do what it took NASA 3 years to do 60 years ago, and Branson's flight still only went half as high. But yeah, the private sector is where it's at. Speaking of Alan Shepard, he's who the Blue Origin vehicle that's going to carry Jeff Bezos to space this week is named after. It's not a very well-chosen name, though, since New Shepard won't fly as high as the original Shepard did either. But hey, a billionaire is going to do something less impressive than a thing NASA did in 1961, so it's exciting, I guess. Who was Alan Shepard? He was the first American in space. He flew his Mercury mission on May 5th, 1961, which is my birthday. Or rather, it would be my birthday. I wasn't born until 1980. But when I was about 5 years old and I learned that the first American in space had flown in space on the same date that I was born, I instantly connected with that and wanted to know everything about him. Alan Shepard was in the U.S. Navy. So was my dad. So was his dad. That's really where the similarities end. Alan Shepard's grandfather owned a bank. Alan attended prestigious private schools, graduated from the Naval Academy, and became an aviator. My father was an enlisted man, not an officer, and an engineer, not an aviator. Even so, those similarities, as tenuous as they were enough to allow me to identify with Alan Shepard, to feel that he wasn't so unlike people I knew in my own life, or me. He was more privileged than me growing up, but he wasn't super rich. He'd served in the same branch of the military as my father. Under slightly different circumstances, he could be me. I could be him. I could be like him, anyway. I don't know that I could ever be like Richard Branson or Jeff Bezos or Elon Musk. Please, God, not Elon Musk. But Alan Shepard? Gus Grissom? John Glenn? Neil Armstrong? Sure, they're larger-than-life figures, and their accomplishments are historic, but they lived and worked in an everyday world not so different from mine, or yours, probably. And while they and their accomplishments were fantastic, they weren't implausible or unattainable. They didn't reach outer space, orbit the Earth, or walk on the moon because they were rich enough to finance their own private space programs. They did all those things because they were chosen as the best people to carry out those particular missions by NASA. The space program. Our space program. They did that in our name. They represented us. And yeah, it's still political, it's still nationalistic. The moon landings were motivated by our desire to beat the Soviets in an international dick-measuring contest. I acknowledge all of that. But NASA is a government agency, a public agency, not a private company, not a commercial company, not a for-profit company. As a lifelong space nerd, as an unapologetic supporter of human spaceflight, it pains me to see how public interest in the space program has dwindled down to almost nothing in my lifetime. And that pain is not relieved, but aggravated by people suddenly becoming fascinated by rocket launches again just because this rocket has a billionaire sitting on top of it. In 1969, the year of the first moon landings, NASA's budget was equivalent to around 2.15% of the federal budget of the United States. In 2010, the year the Constellation Project was canceled for being too expensive, NASA's budget was 0.53% of the federal budget. In 2020, NASA's budget was 0.38% of the federal budget. We're told NASA has no choice but to turn transportation of the astronauts to the space station over to the private sector because it's just too expensive. But NASA's budget today is less than 18% of what it was during the height of the Apollo program. So we give NASA less money, which then forces NASA to give some of that money to private companies to pay them to do something NASA could do by itself if we just gave it some more money. Then the private companies take the spacecraft they developed in part with the money they got from NASA and operate space tourism businesses that make them billions more dollars. It kind of seems like NASA is just being used to funnel money from the federal budget to Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos. And don't we do that enough already through the tax code? Come on! The space program is expensive. But it's not nearly as expensive as most of its detractors think it is. Like I said, when we were literally landing people on the moon, NASA's annual budget was only a little over 2% of the total federal budget. I don't begrudge private companies like SpaceX or Blue Origin or Virgin Galactic running space tourism businesses. Shit, launch as many billionaires into space as you want. Launch them all into space. But our national space program should not be shrinking while the private spaceflight industry is growing. NASA shouldn't have to subcontract transporting crew members to the space station, for God's sake. We should prioritize funding ambitious NASA projects like Artemis, which seeks to return humanity to the moon and eventually to Mars, so that soon we can watch a rocket launch carrying humans into space and know that every person sitting on top of that rocket is an astronaut, not a billionaire cosplaying as one.